through the pneumonia, one of the most terrible things that could possibly have taken place came to pass. As I sat there on the edge of the pool with my four friends, feeling the sun and the water and the sounds of a community, it happened. My father arrived back home from work. I saw his kind face as soon as he walked up to that gate outside the pool. He often rubbed his long arthritic legs while he walked. His green eyes wrinkled in a sweet smile, his long Jewish nose and bald head shining red in the sun. At 6 feet tall, he rose above most others in the pool area. His big hands clutched a brown paper bag full of rolls. He always brought home rolls, always asked if he wanted something to eat, as if he was back in the concentration camp, finally able to slip bits of food to the skeletal children he had in reality and forced to watch die of starvation. When he came through that iron gate, every bit of my happiness and newfound confidence evaporated. I knew he was drunk by the way he walked, his toes stubbing the ground, his steps short and sliding. It took my breath away, and I didn't want my friends to see him. Lila! He called out loud and slow, his voice full of alcohol and fatherly love. The law at the end of my name exaggerating his affection. I could hear a rush of blood in my ears, panic. I wanted to run. Lila, he called with relief, having seen me across the pool. I grabbed my little brother in my towel and hunching over ran toward him, hoping none of my friends had seen him. But the four of them just sat there on the edge of the pool staring. I grabbed my father's arm and practically dragged him from the pool area. My Lila, he said slowly, his bloodshot eyes tearing up, as if he had found me after years of searching. I just wanted to say hello. I hope he couldn't see it at the time, but I didn't want him around. He worked all night and slept during the day. His drinking was an embarrassment to me. I didn't want to be different anymore. I wanted to be just like my friends with their normal families, their normal fathers who worked normal jobs and didn't carry bags of rolls everywhere they went. We took the elevator up to the apartment, and I felt so alone, so different. My little brother and I got into bed. Are you hungry? My father asked again, trying to sit up, his voice slurred and his eyes watery. Go to sleep, Papa, I begged him, turning out his light. Everyone deals with grief differently, and because my parents had lost everything in the war, my father became an alcoholic, and unfortunately, that's the most I remember about him. He passed away at the age of 69, way too soon. And you know, there was so much that I wanted to talk to him about. So many things I wanted to say and so many unanswered questions, but somehow I just couldn't.
To all my father held so dear.